This talk is on Black Adventist historiography, and of course, historiography is the process of doing history and presenting it or distributing it. So in that process of doing it, it is not only interpretation and analysis, but the distribution of it, how it's conveyed. So this is a very dynamic and even communal process that we want to look at. I am not claiming to be exhaustive in this presentation. I'm going to share the parts of Black Adventist historiography that are most prominent to me. So please forgive the oversights. Just to start off, and this will give us a definite grounding for this lecture, and that's to look at who are the major historians or those that do Black Adventist historiography. And this is important for perspective. And we're going to talk about near the end of this presentation on what needs to be done for Black Adventist historiography going forward. And so this will really bear into that. The typical historian of Black Adventism, and I think that I probably fit into all of these, male, African American, and I'm mainly going to cover African American historiography as opposed to Afro-Caribbean, Black Caribbean, African, European, South American. So I'm going to focus on the United States historiography. So African American, theologically educated, that's for any one of your degrees, a minister or administrator, and this is within the denomination. So most Black Adventist historians are or have been denominationally employed. This is very important. This is very important. So they're denominationally employed, and they are usually middle-aged and older. Male, African-American, theologically educated, and that's Adventist theology, ministers and administrators, denominationally employed, and middle-aged and older. These are the types of Black Adventist historiography that I will be touching on during this presentation, and I think that these pretty much cover the gamut. There are probably minor ones that I'm missing, but these would be the major ones, and they are not necessarily exclusive. Many of them may overlap, and you may look at these and say that there are some similarities between them, but they're all nuanced a little bit differently, and I'll tell you about these. Okay, so type one is a chronicle. This is a very basic, but I consider essential type of history, and that is, as closely as possible, you're simply saying what happened. So there are a lot of dates, there are a lot of names here, there's a lot of spare telling of just what happened. Now, of course, as every type of history is, this is biased. It's subjective because it's presented from a perspective, but it's pretty much bare bones. This happened at this date. This happened next. So now, of course, someone could say, well, how do they know what to tell or what type of perspective to come from? So there is that. Okay, a narrative is similar, but it takes a chronicle or a chronology, and it tries to create a story out of that. And this may seem like a rather obvious process because humans think and learn in stories. But of course, with the narrative, there has to be a beginning, middle, and end. And so you choose where to begin, you choose where to end. There's a perspective, and there are probably, when it's a narrative, there are probably lessons that the narrator is trying to bring out in the story. Okay, apologetic it has nothing to do with an apology. It's more like a defense. So you are defending, you are writing a history as a defense. So there is some sort of element when you're writing that I need to explain this in a certain way, or I need to share this history that defends something. And most often it's defending the church. It may be defending Ellen White. It may be defending certain positions. Okay. Triumphalist means that you are writing or sharing history, and it's necessarily going to take a certain trajectory or have a certain point or purpose. And that point or purpose is the church is fulfilling God's will. It is moving toward its divine destiny, which is going to culminate in the second coming. The church is fulfilling the three angels' messages, preaching the gospel to all the world. It may have had some hiccups or some impediments, but ultimately it's always going upward and onward. So that's a triumphalist narrative. Pedagogical simply means that history is to teach something, and there's usually a definite point. There has been a lot of that with women's ordination. There has been a lot of that lately with social justice and anti-racism. So you are sharing history, maybe not so much for itself, but there's a definite point. There's a definite reason that you're trying to teach and instill through that history. Like this somewhat is protest history. And so you're writing history as a form of protest. And usually with this type, you are highlighting areas of the past that speak to the present. And most of the time in that history of the past, you are showing how people protested something that's still going on in the present. And this is a little bit different than pedagogical, and it's somewhat different than polemical, although type 3 apologetic and type 7 polemical have a lot. Polemical is just where you are engaging in an argument. And so, you know, there may be a notion, let's say, that regional conferences were started because Black people wanted to be away from whites, which of course is absurd. But you may write a history of regional conferences addressing that and saying, no, Blacks wanted inclusion, and it was just the opposite. The whites didn't want to include Blacks. So that would be a polemical sort of history. And then academic and scholarly, like I said, all of the previous types of history can be academic or scholarly, but this is when you are intentionally engaging with the wider scholarship. So if it's Adventism, you may engage with the wider scholarship of religion in America. If it's Black Adventism, Black religion in America. Let's say intellectual histories, social histories, regional histories. So you are engaging with that historiography to show where Adventism fits in or extends some sort of knowledge about history. Okay, so these are the major types, and I'm going to be mentioning these throughout the presentation, but this is an important slide and important types. And you can also take these, I think, with wider Adventist histories and perhaps wider histories of the United States, North America, Western world, global history, you know, whatever types of history that you're engaging in, African history, European history. Okay, the main incubation sites of Black Adventist historiography are schools. And that should be no surprise. Not only formalized for fulfilling some requirement for a class, but the faculty and staff at schools. And of course, the only HBCU in Adventism is Oakwood University. So much of the Black Adventist historiography has come out of Oakwood University, either Oakwood students or faculty or staff. Also, though, Andrews University, and specifically the Adventist Theological Seminary, because you recall who we said the criteria for most Black Adventist historians, many of them, perhaps most of them, have come through the Andrews Theological Seminary, and the dissertations there, the theses and dissertations there, are a major mine and resource of Black Adventist history. So these sites are important. Okay, there are many ways that Black Adventists do history. Here I will mainly be referring to books, but of course, history is done in many ways, and this is in no way exhaustive. You can see that I don't even have museums here, but history is done in many ways. So I don't want to make it, I don't want to make you think that it's solely books. Of course, there's the classroom, church services and programs, educational materials that would sort of align with the classroom. Increasingly and prevailingly on the web, of course, biography and memoir is a major source of history, and those biographical resources are used to do history. Online panels, especially from the summer of 2020 on, during the COVID quarantine and the Black Lives Matter protests, as I mentioned, dissertations, and of course, reference works, that is, it's always been an element, but now with the new encyclopedia of Seventh-day Adventists, that is an online reference work that has terrific materials on Black Adventist history. And of course, magazines and journals. So here you see some of the major ones, of course, Adventist Review. These are online. I chose some online. Spectrum, Regional Voice, Adventist Heritage is now defunct, but that was a very important Oregon medium for history. The different regional Adventist magazines, Oakwood magazines. So these are some of the places in print magazines and online magazines where history is done. All right, so let's go a little bit into Black Adventist history, and I will be highlighting, like I said, the works, the people, the trends that I think are important. The first Black Adventist history per se, I would say, was Lights and Shades in the Black Belt, and that's by Arthur Spaulding. This was never published. He completed this from around 1912 to 1914, and this was encouraged by Ellen White, James Edson White, and others, that a history be done of Black Adventism, specifically the work in the South. And I don't exactly know why this was not published. Some say it was not published because it was a hopeless prisoner of its time, and it is biased and racist. I've read this many times. I don't see how it's more racist than anything else that came from that period. So I think it's a very valuable book, despite its shortcomings. So you can find this book online. You can find it on blacksdahistory.org. You can find it on adventistarchives.org. I think you can find it in the Adventist Digital Library. Just Google it. The PDF should come up. And so this looks at the Black work purely from the perspective of the South. So think the postbellum South after the Civil War. Spaulding actually does a good job of situating the Adventist endeavor, the Adventist missional endeavor in the South, in the wider milieu, which is very necessary, of course. And so this is not purely just a chronicle or a narrative. This actually really has some academic and scholarly notes to it, because Spaulding is to a certain extent engaged with the currents of the time, and he's using non-Adventist sources. One could criticize this by saying that it utilizes the white savior model, and that is a fair assessment. We now know that the work in the South was not just James Edson White and Emma White and Will Palmer and others, but that there were all sorts of things going on in the South, all sorts of Blacks who were involved with the rise of Adventism in the South, not only as evangelists and workers and Bible workers and call porters, but many read themselves into Adventism. So they had that agency, and there wasn't, you know, there were no white saviors. And also in the Southern Missionary Society itself, you know, James Edson's group, there were many Blacks that helped the SMS to run. Like, of course, Finnis Parker, who captained the ships, and, you know, it was against the law in certain places on the Mississippi River for Blacks to captain a ship. So he would have to duck out, you know, when they got near like a port in Memphis or what have you, or when the authorities would come. There were Black cooks, there were Black teachers, there were Black Bible workers. So the SMS was in no ways just a white enterprise. It was multicultural. But I digress on that. So do check out Arthur Spaulding's book. This is not cited much in later Black Adventist historiography. So I would question its influence, because of course it was never published, but it's nevertheless a good source. This is a product of the Academy. This and the next piece. So this is H.D. Singleton, who of course became a very prominent figure in Black Adventist history. And this one is a very good, not only period piece, sort of like Arthur Spaulding's is, but it gives very essential facts, because we know that, you know, to do Adventist history, we need the basics. So this is more chronological and narrative. But like with Spaulding, it also engages academically and with scholarship. But I would put this more in, you know, giving the facts. And this is actually very essential to this class period, to this time period, because a lot of the facts were not known. And so you'll see an odyssey, a development of Black Adventist history, in which once the facts have been established, now there can be more analysis and interpretation of them. But this is still the period where the facts had to be established. And this is also done for the Theological Seminary, which at the time was in Washington. It wasn't in Andrews yet. And this was obviously the hot spot, a study on, you know, the hot spot of early Black Adventism, which is Alabama, Mississippi. That would be where the Southern Missionary Society and the Morning Star boat went, you know, down the or up the Mississippi, Yazoo, Lintonia, Vicksburg, and then in Huntsville, Alabama, with the Oakwood Enterprise and the other areas around there. So this is really the center of early Black Adventism. And it's interesting that some of these works really, that these figures of such importance in Black Adventist history, so this is not just historiography, but are doing these works as their master's thesis. Okay, so they have that historical grounding, and they go on to make a major contribution to Black Adventism. And of course, O.B. Edwards did this as a professor and a musician at Oakwood University. All right, this really goes into some triumphalism, but also a kind of, it's not a polemic or apologetic, but in some ways they are. Now, these are some early works by Black Adventists, 1950s and 60s. And these are all denominationally published. And what they're doing is they are linking the Black struggle, Black sojourn in America, and that is Black writ large. So enslavement, and this is really from, you know, the transatlantic slave trade to slavery in America, to the Civil War, Reconstruction, Jim Crow, and they are painting a narrative. They are weaving a narrative of God's providence throughout that. Now, these works do bring Adventism into it, but really these are sort of evangelical pieces, and that could be a type of history that I could have included, evangelistic history, but that would really be along triumphalism. So this is saying, look how God has led Black people in the past. He will continue to lead us in the future and into the second coming and the new earth. So these are by F.L. Peterson, E.E. Cleveland, and Lewis B. Reynolds, major figures in Black Adventist history. All right, I'm going to touch on a couple of historians that I think are important, historians and their efforts that I think are important to Black Adventism. We have Ronald Graybill, and I did an interview with Dr. Graybill that you can look at on the Black SDA History YouTube channel. In 1970, Ron Graybill published E.G. White and Church Race Relations, and this is definitely apologetic and polemical, and this is addressing the contention that Ellen White was racist, and it's interpreting her statements in Testimonies Volume 9 that we should conduct the work along separate Black-White lines until the Lord shows us a better way. So this is Graybill contextualizing those statements. So he's really dealing with the first decade of the 20th century, and Mission to Black America, which came a year or two later. And he's talking about the Morning Star, but also the Southern Missionary Society. And I do think that Ron Graybill is definitely moving away from white saviorism, because in this, Graybill really gives a good picture of the Southern Missionary Society. And don't let the cover fool you. You know, this is just kind of like 70s. It's a 70s cover, but it's a really good history. It's a really good history. And these books would prove foundational and very much quoted in Black Adventist historiography, because Graybill, at the time, he didn't have his doctorate. I think he got his doctorate in 1983 or something like that. But he's a trained historian. Okay. All right. Angels in Ebony is sort of became a cult classic of Black Adventist historiography. And that's not, I shouldn't use the term cult in the context of Adventism, but this developed a big following in Black Adventism, and it is an oft-quoted work. And Jacob Justice, I think he had a history undergrad, but he was also a minister, and he ended up getting a doctorate later in his career. The Angels in Ebony, he self-published it at a press, I believe, in Toledo, Ohio, and it's 1975, and it's a sophisticated history in its way and in its time, because it defies a lot of the categories. There's some chronology, there's some narrative, there's some polemic, there's also some protest. And it draws on, first of all, it gives a lot of facts that are necessary to make the case that Jacob Justice is making. It's not bound to the denomination, so it's not triumphalist. And at the time, I think by this time, Justice was out of denominational employ. So he's not beholden to any office or department or institution in the denomination. So he is rightly critical of Adventism when he needs to be. And so you see in this history, there is that room. that he has to be critical, or at least fair, of Adventism and its history of race. And Justice also weaves in other Black history, wider African-American history in this work. So like I said, this is a very respected work, even though, you know, someone may be distracted by some of the grammatical errors or its idiosyncratic style. This is a very important work of Black Adventism. This is also available on blacksdahistory.org. And just to say something wider about Jacob Justice, he had a tremendous impact on generations of Black Adventists and making them more history-minded through his lectures and sermons. So it goes beyond Angels in Ebony. And in fact, I think that Angels in Ebony was his response, because he was giving so many of these Black history presentations that people were telling him, you need to put this in a book. And so that's what he did. All right, we have tomorrow. This is the first denominationally published history of Black Adventism. Of course, in other works like Origin and Progress, Captain of the Lord's Host, you have, and several others, you have sections and chapters on Black Adventist history. But this is the first one published by the denomination. This is a Review and Herald. So this is 1983. And Lewis B. Reynolds was a prominent Black author. Of course, he was the editor of Message magazine, and he was also a minister. So he held several key posts in the denomination. And We Have Tomorrow is I think it's a great history. This is also on blacksdahistory.org. And I'm always surprised on what Reynolds has included for that time. Obviously, you have to put yourself before the internet, before access to all of these archives, and the way that we're, you know, freely banding about resources. So Lewis B. Reynolds wrote an important history. There are some maybe personal, petty beefs that may have altered this a bit. But for the most part, I think it's a very strong history. It is narrative. It is eminently readable. It is comprehensive. Obviously, it's a history of Black Adventism writ large. And so it doesn't go into, you know, specific areas. It doesn't by any means get granular or even specific like you would want it to. But that wasn't Reynolds's point. And so this is an excellent resource, and it is often quoted. So this is something you will want to take note of. In 1988-89, Seeking a Sanctuary came out, and many people don't know this, but Keith Lockhart is Black. And this book had perhaps, and some have called it, the most influential book on Adventism, and especially Adventist scholarship, because the first edition was, I believe, Harper and Row. Perhaps the first edition was a scholarly press, maybe the University of Tennessee. I'm blanking on it. But then later, it was Harper and Row. I may have that mixed up. But this is a work of sociology, journalism, maybe religious anthropology, if you will, definitely cultural criticism. And there is a section in this book on race. But this really put Adventism on the map because it was interpretive, and it situated Adventism within the context of America. You know that Adventism is one of the few American-born religions. I'm saying a new religion. I'm not speaking of, let's say, Baptists or even, you know, Methodists really came from Anglicanism, but, you know, Adventists would be along with Mormons and Christian Scientists, of a religion that was born in the United States. And so this situates it in that milieu. So it's Seventh-day Adventism and the American Dream. And the analysis is sophisticated, and probing, and it still stands to this day. This is a classic. This is a classic, and once again, often quoted and cited. So Keith Lockhart, he's from the UK, I believe, of Jamaican origin, and this is a massive book in Black Adventist historiography. Delbert Baker, full disclosure, my father also has done much for Black Adventist historiography with his groundbreaking work in 1987, 1988, The Unknown Prophet. And this is something of a polemic because the narrative was that William Foy rejected the prophetic call along with Hayes and Foss. And then Ellen White was chosen because both of them rejected the call. But Baker established that Foy was indeed faithful to the prophetic call. He shared his visions, and importantly, he documented his life. And so once again, the narrative was that Foy rejected the call and then he died. You know, he died a sort of a lost and bereft man when the torch had been passed to Ellen White. But Baker showed that Foy indeed lived to 1893, and he had a very long and fulfilling ministry with the Free Will Baptist and Christian denomination. And then Baker did many other works of history, like Telling the Story, is an anthology that still stands. And these are go-to sources for Black Adventist history. This is 1996, done in consultation cooperation with the Black Caucus. And Baker had post as a message editor and then president of Oakwood. And so obviously to have someone doing history and to hold these posts sort of elevated Black Adventist historiography. So these are important works. The Sabbath in Africa Study Group was started by Elder Charles Bradford, the first Black NAD president, and that's from 79 to 1990. And he started this group to really look at and connect the Adventist past with the growing number of Black Seventh-day Adventists. So after the 1980s, there was an absolute explosion of Adventism during the 1980s, an absolute explosion of Adventism in Africa, in continental Africa. And of course, the diaspora, like the Caribbean, you know, some Caribbean countries like Jamaica, I think Adventists are like 20% of the population or something along those lines. And so Bradford was taking a Seventh-day Sabbath past in Africa, in East Africa, and it's also, you know, borne out in other places as well, West Africa as well. And he was linking this with present-day Black Adventists and showing that there's a continual line. And so he is disputing the claim that Africa was in darkness while Europe was in light. Okay, and several books have come from this, including a book that I consider an unmitigated masterpiece, The Blessing of Africa by Keith Burton, Black Adventist Keith Burton. That book is phenomenal. I recommend that to anyone. Okay, there's Calvin Rock, once again, a higher up administrator in the Adventist Church, Oakwood president, GC vice president, chair of Loma Linda and Andrews board. I could be wrong on one of those, but very upper echelon leader in Adventism and a historian. Perspectives really took different areas of Black Adventist history. And now it definitely is history, but then it could have been social or cultural sort of criticisms and perspectives, and gotten Adventists from those fields, experts in those fields, Black Adventist experts in those fields, and gotten them to comment on it. So there's a lot of history there. And then his latest book, I believe 2018, Protest and Progress, which really provides a framework for Black Adventism, to look at Black Adventist history. And that is in three or four major protests. So this is a very important work. As Doug Morgan says, the most important book published on race relations in the Adventist Church. Okay, Charles Dudley, once again, a longtime administrator. I think that he's the longest serving conference president. He was at South Central Conference. Elder Dudley did history. You can see the books, Thou Who Has Brought Us, and it's volumes one and two. I think he was planning to do a third and fourth volume, but this is, there are two books, but maybe three volumes in two books. And these are very much quoted because Dudley lived Black Adventism, and his recollections and images in there are priceless, really. So this is oft quoted. Mervyn Warren really does history around Oakwood. So you see these three books are really all pertaining to Oakwood, including Mosley, who was an Oakwood legend. And so these are important works. Dr. DeWitt Williams, very prolific Black Adventist writer. Dr. Douglas Morgan, like Ron Graybill, he is a trained historian. And so these works do much to contextualize Black Adventism and really take seriously the, you know, historiographical process. And Doug Morgan also has a book, Adventism and the American Republic, that is published by an academic press. Okay, much of Black Adventist historiography is done through the lens of Ellen White, and a lot of this would be apologetic and polemical. And so you can see that a number of Black Adventist scholars, including myself, they come to Black Adventist history via Ellen White, So a lot of times she's like a gateway to Black Adventist history. So you start maybe doing something polemical or a compilation of Ellen White. And then, you know, from there, you kind of launch into broader Adventist history. And it's obvious why this would be the case, because of course, Ellen White is the co-founder and considered a prophet in Seventh-day Adventist history. And so oftentimes what she writes and what she said determined, highly influenced denominational history. And those quotes are used in different ways. And so obviously a lot of historiography, a lot of writing would be around you know, her quotes and her life. Okay, this is some protest historiography, a very good book, but hard to get. The Problem with Africanity, it looks at Black protest movements throughout the diaspora. Out of the Trash Came Truth. This is on blacksdahistory.org, and that is on the protest led by the inimitable Frank Hale and Miles Martin that resulted in the first Black GC Vice President, F.L. Peterson, of course, Calvin Rock's Protest and Progress, and Doug Morgan's Change Agents. And this is going to be an area that I'm going to comment on later, but these are Black Adventist works from academic presses. And you can see that there is a paucity of them. There may be more, but I don't think so, that are just dedicated to purely Black Adventism. And this is not counting the Andrews University Press. These are secular presses. So you have Clifford Jones's work on James K. Humphrey and London's work on Adventist and the Civil Rights Movement. All right. Now, of course, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the rise of internet sources of Black Adventism. I think most notably, and probably the only site dedicated to Black Adventist history, is a site I began in 2010, blacksdahistory.org, and its accompanying YouTube channel. I could prove to you via stats the impact that it has had. The Black SDA History YouTube channel has about 16,500 subscribers and about 2.4 million views. And it's been shared in a lot of different places and spaces. So there are even more views from it from that. Of course, a lot of times more than one person watches a given video. They may play it in churches. And then the website has many thousands, tens of thousands of visitors every year. All right, the top needs of Black Adventist historiography. Think about that second slide where I profiled the average, the typical Black Adventist historian. So we need women historians. We can very easily deduce why there are not more women Adventist historians. Obviously, right now, women in the Seventh-day Adventist Church cannot be officially ordained. And so, there's a broader and wider context to that. And that is, you know, men tending to be ministers in almost every major Christian denomination. And so women are less likely to study for the ministry and so come in contact with that Adventist history and develop a passion for that, and less likely to be in the seminary and Oakwood, you know, Oakwood theology, where those studies really emanate from and where that passion for Black history originates. So we need more women historians, of course, in Adventism, but in Black Adventism. Situating Black Adventism in wider contexts, it's not serving us anymore to act like Black Adventism happened in a vacuum. Most all of Black Adventism is explicable by what's happening in wider society. I know why this happens once again, because we want to act like we are not of this world and we are not worldly and we are above the world, but we are very worldly. Believe me, we are very, very extremely worldly. We are as worldly as it gets. Okay. Everything that's happened in Black Adventism has firmly happened on this earth, in this world, in our human bodies. Okay. Another thing we need are histories of Black Adventist diaspora locations. Certain Caribbean countries don't have much work done on them at all. South America, of course, Blacks in South America, Europe, Canada, and interpreting Black Adventism for secular and scholarly audiences. To a large degree, we have been talking to ourselves about Adventist history and Black Adventist history. So we need to interpret it and make it understandable for those who are not Adventist, into a scholarly audience. Thank you.